Bom, boa tarde a todos, né? Em primeiro lugar, eu quero agradecer a presença, né? Porque eu sei que vocês tiveram aí, acho que todos assistiram a aula do o minicurso do professor Andras, né? E, então, certamente estão ainda bastante envolvidos com a qualidade da apresentação dele. É, eu não estive aqui, mas assisti a anterior lá em São José, então sei que tem, assim, muita profundidade, ele é muito entusiasmado e querendo fazer, assim, de fato as pessoas entenderem. Então, foi, assim, um ganho muito grande, né? E eu sei que todos aproveitaram bem aí. E para dar continuidade a essa parte, né, nós temos então a segunda fase, o segundo módulo deste ciclo, né, que é do professor Bondavalli, Andrea Bondavalli. Andrea é colega nosso há algum tempo, faz parte do grupo de pesquisa de Dependable Computing e toda a área de sistemas tolerantes a falhas, a parte de safety, né, de segurança, tanto security quanto safety, mais safety. E, então, ele é full professor da Universidade de Florença, né, University of Firenze. E, bom, ele também é líder e chefe do departamento, né, e da área do laboratório de computação resiliente. Então, é uma pessoa super experiente. Tivemos aí, por conta deste projeto Advance, como eu comentei na primeira abertura do curso do Andres, é via este projeto Advance que a gente teve, então, a oportunidade de recebê-los, né? Eles estão sendo pagos pela União Europeia. O projeto foi aprovado no contexto, né, do H2020, que é o programa Horizon 2020, financiado pela União Europeia, e receberemos, assim como eles, outros experientes professores e visitantes aqui. Então, agradeço, hoje eu vou fazer parte da turma, e não só hoje, como esse curso todo, porque desse eu não assisti. Então, bom, Andrea, thank you very much for your coming. And so
obrigado, muito obrigado. Boa tarde. Boa tarde. This closes my Portuguese. So, now we switch to English. The short course that I'm going to teach you today and in the next days is part of a master course that we offer at the University of Florence. We have a master on resilient and secure cyber physical systems, and this is probably the basic course for the entire master program. Okay, so I had to cut because in 75 teaching hours we can go for about 15 to 20. So I decided to take some of the topics, and I took the topics that, in my view, are more fun to talk about, and let's say the basic concept on cyber physical systems and the consequences that this basic concept should imply when we go to design or to analyze and put into production a cyber physical systems, and mostly a system of system. Today, isolated systems have little meaning, and what we are seeing is more and more integration of autonomous systems which become big infrastructure and that need to be coordinated properly. Okay, so let me see if I can have this thing going. First, Florencia is a relatively small place but a relatively old one. We had the golden age in the Renaissance, and there are some leftover of this golden age. It's one of the top touristic place, I would say, in Italy for sure, but also in the world, which makes living there not easier than otherwise, because everything is always crowded by tourists. So you feel always a stranger in your place because everything is made for. Florence is the main city in Tuscany, and in, say, couple of hours driving, you can reach very different places, like Pisa or the Siena. We have pictures of Pisa here and Siena here, plus the coast, plus the Tuscany hills, and so on. Fine. University. University is a relatively big university in Italy. Is we have about 60,000 students. Small percentage are also foreign, and we are trying to push to internationalization more and more. You see the numbers of professors, researchers, fellows, and so on. And again, our group is part of the Department of Mathematics and Informatics, which are joined together is computer science, in a sense, and not engineers, though we are considered more engineers than computer scientists. Now, let's start with the real description of the of our topic. System of system era. Okay, if we want to briefly go through the evolution of computing, we can see that in around 50 years ago, there were mainframes. Looks ages, but it's just 50 years ago. They were large computer, execute big data processing application, very centralized, and users had to go to that. They were in big rooms and they were really gigantic. Then we had desktop computers and workstation, and the appearance of internet in the 80s and the 90s. So one computer at every desk. I was so happy when we had each of us its own computer and not to go to the center and so on and so forth. And network, mostly area net, local area network, but it was possible to share a lot of resources and so on. The development of networks made possible the what we can call ubiquitous computing. Say, many computer devices placed in almost everywhere, even personal. I mean, I have a personal area network which my device is all connected together. It's invisible, it's permeating the environment. You don't notice anymore these things, and still they are there. And they are much, much more than computers. We have millions of computers and we have billions now of these things which are all around us. And this is, let's say, cyber stuff. All this process has been somehow detached from the physical reality, which is the next step that we are taking now when we talk about cyber physical systems. We had embedded systems which are isolated and so on. And now we want also to permeate the physical world around us. What is a cyber physical system? Well, we had some discussion in the previous day on what is a cyber physical system. Here is my view. Cyber physical system is something which has a cyber part which deals with computation, communication, and control. These things are discrete. And you have instruction, you have a discrete time evolution of the systems, and so on. You have a physical part. A physical part which is what it was the embedded controlled system, which is a physical system. Take a car or any other device which now has attached some computation power, but is physical. And physics obeys to the rules of time, continuous time, physical time. It's not a discrete time. When I have an inertial movement, I have a notion of time which is continuous. Things can happen in every instant, and there's no, say, cycle or place or a clock cycle to drive me and to make it discrete. And then a cyber physical system is a system which groups these things together as a cyber part, as a physical part, and possibly humans interacting with that. A very intelligent car is a cyber physical system as a physical part, the engine, the wheels, the seats, everything. There's I was attending a presentation given by some manager of Daimler Benz, and they said that in their high-class Mercedes, if you put 100 lines on a piece of paper and you put these foils one over the other, now they can reach more than the moon. If you pile all the software, okay? So, it's a cyber system in this sense. And then someone is going to drive and to act and to contribute to the mission of this cyber physical system, which is the driver. Okay? So, a cyber physical system is something like that. And I think this statement is very important. CPS will transform how we interact with the physical world, just like the internet transformed how we interact with one another. Okay, I mean, you are most of you are quite young, and probably you are native of Facebook or all these other things, but say social media transformed the way people interact. Before this happening, people were interacting among each other in a different way than they do now, right? And the advent of cyber physical system will transform the way we deal with the physical world as much as this previous innovation transformed the way we were interacting with each other. Okay, now we are ready, apparently, to take also the physical part of the world into this kind of different relationship and different management. Okay, so if we want to start from monolithic systems, again, we have to understand what was in order to understand what we are having now and what are the new challenges. Okay. So, computers were characterized by distinguishable services, not clearly separated. I mean, everything was all together, interwoven in their implementations, data input and output, processing, error handling, user interface. They were somehow mixed. It was a blob, we say. It was mixed. And this monolithic architecture defines what was the monolithic software system. Okay, now, many of the assumptions that we made in classical system, and now we list them, are not essentially or mostly justified in modern cyber physical software system. Like the scope of the system is known. If I take infrastructure composed by cyber physical systems interacting to each other, and I think to an entity which is meant to live for decades, it's very hard to say that we know what is the scope of the system. The scope will change, it's going to change, so we have to be adaptable in designing and operating a system in order to account to the change that will happen anyway, even if today we are not able to foresee. But it is not acceptable for us that we are building such a huge system and think that the system will never change until his disposal. It will. So we have to be prepared to that. The design phase of a system is terminated by an acceptance test. For old-fashioned control, critical control system, this was true. I was, imagining the system, making probably an hazard analysis in order to understand what was dangerous and what was not, define requirement based on that analysis, and then make the provision for building a system which was fulfilling this requirement, verify and validate everything, making also testing and everything else, and when everything was finally ready, I could operate my system. And the system was operating according to that mission until this disposal. It was a very easy job. I have everything under my control, I know almost everything, I have to make a good job before challenge I have, and then I operate this, and then it's over. Well, if you take the power distribution infrastructure, can you imagine anything like that? Every day you add solar cell production, you dispose something else, you add a new system, so there's never a point in which the system is finished, you have an acceptance test and you operate the system. It's a completely dynamic process which cannot be approached in this way. Okay. You prepare part of the system to go to substitute maybe obsolete parts and so on, so you have an evolution, but there's no point in which you make an assessment and an acceptance test before operating your system. Last, faults are exceptional events. I mean, I've been dealing with safety critical systems for all my professional life, I would say. And okay, we designed and operated, for example, some of the early train control systems for railway and so on. A few computers, a few network, I mean, relatively small systems, and clearly faults were exceptional events. Now, if I take a grid, or if I take the system of teller ATM worldwide, can I say that faults are exceptional events? If I take the Google computing centers, faults are not exceptional events. When I take thousands and thousands of computing elements, the normal situation is that some of them are not functioning, and some are. And we have to live with this kind of situation in which our system is not, the state of our system in any point of time is not made only by properly working components. Some of them are faulty. So this is, again, a change that we have to account. Now, system of system comes from the integration of existing systems most of the time. Okay, we are observing these systems of systems, but we are observing that they appear because we have been able or we wanted to integrate previously isolated systems. And some of them are even very old. Also in satellite business, this is happening all the time, because you build a new thing, integrate one and so on, and at the end, constellation or bigger, let's call it system of system. And you didn't design from scratch. You design some part, you build some part, and you use parts which were there for, from years, for decades. So, comes from the integration of existing system, some legacy. They are normally operated by different organizations. Okay. Bank, different organization. Even railways. Now in Europe we have this European railway standard which make interoperable all the trains made according to this standard in all the lines in Europe. And obviously there are companies which own trains and companies which owns a part of the infrastructure. So the system of system is not owned by the same organization. Okay, and this obviously for the management and the evolution of the system is important to consider. Different is if I own everything and I can decide whatever I want. Different is if I own part of the system of system and I have to agree with the owners of the other part in order to evolve. Okay, and then we have also new system which play important roles in all this picture. But it's a very complex situation which is coming out of reality, because this is not something that we decided to do and then was made. It's something which happened. And then we can see this paradigm of cyber physical system in many view. For example, here we have the integration with let's say the cloud as well. But we have cyber physical systems which are in the border of the physical world. We have sensing of everything. We can have very sophisticated processing of all this information, and then we can decide how we go to modify the environment, and we have actuation. So we have, through the cyber physical systems, a much finer and much better control of how we can modify or control pieces of the world, parts of the world. For example, integrated transport systems are essentially done in this way. We collect information from all the different sources, we can process and we can make decisions on how the system has to be managed for proper operation. The core problems. Well, you see that on the left of this picture, we have that system or cyber physical systems can, let's say, be used for a set of applications: smart traffic, automotive, driving cars, Internet of Things, robotic, agriculture, smart cities. We have embedded or control system. We have formal methods. We have optimization, and then we have to solve some of the core problems that we have in there, because this complexity obviously requires that we are able to ensure privacy for the people which are around these systems, security, and also and dependability in broader term. We need, especially if we think of big infrastructure, that if this infrastructure work properly, it becomes really a problem if they don't, because we rely upon their working, okay, more and more, because they are more central in our day life. Then if we look the right figure, there's a bit of detailing of this concept. We have, again, different words if you want to say, to express the same concern. We want these systems to be available, to keep confidentiality for those things which are needed, to be reliable, to be safe in those cases in which a failure can harm people or the environment or else. We need to have integrity, so the state of the system must be kept correct. And okay, so it's a mix of all these properties which are essential for the proper working. Now, again, relationship of a cyber physical system with many of the buzzwords which are now, at least in Europe, on top of the scene, are, for example, here is the industry 4.0 evolution if we take the agricultural application area. You see, you have a product, then the product mechanical has become intelligent with some control, then you could operate by remote, and then you can have a system of these things, and finally you can integrate everything together, and here you come to the system of system level, which is the intelligent farming industry 4.0 paradigm. How cyber physical systems relate to Internet of Things? Well, you have the internet, you have collection application of data, you have the cloud, and then you have cyber physical system, which brings close to the physical reality. You can collect all this information and also be able to act on a global scene. This is very German as a slide. In a sense that they have been pushing, at least in Europe, for the last 10 years for Industry 4.0 and to convince the Commission to invest a lot of money in this paradigm. And this is explained what is, for them, this thing. You see, Industrial Revolution, 18th century, then the start of the 20th century, the Industrial Revolution 2, okay, John Ford and the pipeline, modern industries. And then you have in the 70s, the introduction of electronics, which was another step. And now you have the fourth industrial revolution, which is based on cyber physical systems. Okay, the electronics is able to, let's say, integrate and arrange everything to go to this kind of integrated systems, which, factory automatization, integration of production, distribution, and everything is made really possible in an automatic way by this technology. Application domains, almost everything, right? From healthcare to transportation to process control, large-scale infrastructures, defense, telemedicine and telemanipulation, and so on. Okay. This was just to provide, a description of setting the scene. Systems of systems, as it was apparent from what I said so far, are characterized by hierarchies. It's multi-level hierarchy. When I say the traffic is the car, the traffic light, and so on, and then the automotive traffic system. If I speak of integrated transport, I have cars, I have trains, I have planes, and then again, I have a hierarchy and I can go down and down. Okay, so it's the concept itself of system of system cannot be split by the concept of hierarchical recursion. Okay. And this is very important as a concept. I mean, I can see a system, which is what I am interested in, and I see as a system, as a whole, is one single entity, if I look at it from one viewpoint. But then I can also open the box and I see a set of subsystems. And each of these subsystems can be decomposed further. But what is important here, what I want to point out, is that we can see a whole whose behavior is somehow, described when we open the box and we see the subsystems and their interactions. Okay, so we can talk of a macro level in which we see the whole, and the micro level in which we see the parts and their interactions. And then we can take a subsystem, open, and see there are smaller subsystems which interact to provide traffic, cars and other things. I take a car, if I open a car, I find today more than 100 channels. And if I open again, it's a multi-core with many components again. And so I can move on until the point in which I'm happy and I'm not interested to decompose further. It's my decision. I could go on. Okay. And clearly, when I don't want to explode anymore, I have a component. It's an atomic entity, and then I can build this kind of hierarchies. So let's try to summarize now. I mean, all these things I will take again, obviously, in the next days. It's just for introducing some of the problems. Main difference between the monolithic approach and the system of system approach. The scope of the system, in one case, was fixed, now is essentially unknown, at least in the entire life of the system. Clearly, that today I have a scope for my system of system, but in 5 years the scope may change. So, in general, it is unknown. Clock synchronization. When I have a monolithic system with a few nodes, I can think of internal clock synchronization, internal to the system component. Okay. Even if I have a ground and a satellite, still they can synchronize to each other, and that's okay. That's enough, because they need to be, to go in pace together. When I speak about the system of system, I need a global time synchronization. And this global time synchronization cannot be reached by a distributed algorithms among the billions of elements we have. So we have to go to an external source of time. And I will speak more about that. The structure. In a monolithic system, we have a very hierarchical structure, say. In systems of systems, we have network which connect together the different systems which compose the system of system, in which authority is not always in the same way. Sometimes authority is centralized, sometimes it is not, but we cannot say that it is fixed. Requirement and specification. As I said, for a traditional system, I fix my requirement, I build the system is okay for those requirements, I operate, and then I dispose the system. So they are fixed. In a system of system, they are changing. They are changing because I want evolution. A very simple example of change is when new st- standards or new rules are defined for operating a system. Okay, I have a system running, a new provision for a new standard comes out, for example, in Europe, the privacy stuff, and all the system have to be modified in order to be compliant with the new regulation. And this has determined an evolution, for example, of the bank system. Okay, so the requirements are changing. Evolution. In a traditional system, I have versions. I can issue a new version of a system, that's it. Well, in a system of system in which the different system components are not owned by the same organization, most of the time I cannot have a global decision on when to change some of the systems. If a company, a train company, builds a new trains, okay, they build a new train, so there are new components, they have obviously to obey some requirement, but they have new components that no one can say anything about. So the evolution is sometimes non-coordinated. There's no global coordination to say, let's make a new step. Different parts can evolve in a different way and different speed. Testing. Well, for monolithic system, we have test phases, unit testing, integration testing, and so on. And then it's over. Okay. In a system of system where I have new component and new systems which are integrated, I can perform continuous testing for the entire life of the system. Okay. Think to service-oriented architectures. You are providing a service, and for doing this, you are using other services. And people who provide these services can change versions without you even know. How can you be sure that the new version is still doing what you are expecting that it is doing, or the previous version were doing? In reality, the new version was designed and prepared by the owner of this service, probably without the guy would even not know what you were using his service for, or didn't care about your concerns or your constraints. New thing is out and you don't know whether you can use it, or if using it is still correct for achieving your goal. How can you solve this problem? You have to continuously test anytime you find something new. Implementation. Implementation in the old days was I fix the technology. Okay, I try to buy spare parts if the system has to go for long time, but the technology is fixed. In a system of system, you don't even know which is the technology used in the different parts. So you don't have any constraint or any limitation in that, and you cannot make any assumption. Sometimes properties were assured because that specific component was not able to behave in a given way and so on. Here, you have this uncoordinated evolution, clearly the same properties not holding. As we already said, faults, both physical and design faults. In monolithic classic system, they were considered, and they were, exceptional events. In a huge infrastructure, they are not exceptional events. I mean, they are normal in the sense that during the system lifetime, we see and we observe many of these events. Control was central and now is more or less autonomous. Emergence was insignificant and now is very important. And and I will come, I will have a full lecture on emergence. It's the one I enjoy most. And system development. We had many process models, system engineering or software engineering models to describe the life cycle of a system and so on. I mean, this can be still valid for components, but it's hard to say that you can apply the same kind of concept to a system of system in its generality. Okay. Yes. Absolutely. Anytime, any of you can make questions, guys.
It's about the taxonomy.
Yeah.
The first time that I heard of the taxonomy of the seller was the but I'm curious about the when this taxonomy is cyber business was common, what was started in papers in general. Because I remember quickly when the word individuals and the word Internet of Things happens. And I remember the papers and the
news. Sure.
But how about the cyber business?
I don't know the precise answer. I mean, it's something that people started using and so on, and at some point it emerged as something that everybody was talking, but I think it's the beginning of these decades people started talking about cyber physical systems. To me, cyber physical system is a buzzword, if you want my opinion, because also an embedded system was a system with control and physical part. But previously it was seen as, let's say, a physical system which is there. I make a control and I make sensors and actuators to somehow have the desired behavior by the physical mechanical system. Probably now a cyber physical system is something which is more integrated. I mean, the control is within the physical part and can move if the physical part move with that and so on. Still is a combination of cyber and physical parts. Okay, being physical, you can have movement, you can have inertial kind of stuff, and you have to obey the laws of physics, most important. But now they are no more one here, they are all together, they move together and they have networking, and so they can be connected to everybody else. But I would say that I consider the concept of system of systems much more important than cyber physical system. Okay? Because system of system is what gives you new problem, new challenges, and a new vision and challenges to solve, in a sense. Because if it was cyber physical system, if I take all the theory from control systems and embedded systems, classical old real-time stuff and so on, I don't feel so uneasy to be able to manage. When we go to a system of system, which can be a full infrastructure with thousands of components, which you even don't know, and you have to somehow coordinate everything in order to reach a specific goal, then the challenge is important. Okay, so that's the real new part and new challenging part of all this discussion. Okay, let's move on. Now, in this set of slides, I don't make the necessary emphasis. It's just a short sentence here, but I would consider this thing very important. Reduce the cognitive effort needed to comprehend the behavior of a system of system or of a system in general. I mean, we are humans, we are very limited, and when things becomes too complex, we are no more able to master this complexity. Okay? And things are becoming very, very complex. So we need to find ways to limit the complexity in order to be able to master the stuff. This is really important to us, and here I'm speaking for the consortium of the project in which we did all of this. It's really important to reduce the cognitive complexity, because if you don't take any measure to reduce the cognitive complexity, you reach immediately a limit that you are no more able to master. And if you are no more able to master, you make mistakes, you don't understand how the system works. I mean, you are not able to really do what to achieve what you want to do. Okay, so mastering complexity is important. Okay, and again, to master complexity, mankind has only one, essentially one strategy, which is hierarchies. I have to make different levels of a hierarchy so that each level is sufficiently simple for me to master. I solve problem to this level, and then I move to the level upper with a limited set of open problems, and so on. So, and this is the only thing that mankind devised for really mastering and reducing complexity, hierarchies. Now, again, in order to limit this, we also thought that we are better to look at system of system according to several different viewpoints. Because again, if you concentrate on some specific characteristics, and we talk only of that characteristics, it may be easier to understand and to decide what we have to do instead of looking everything together. The dimensions that we want, that we defined in order to reason about system of systems, are fundamental concepts, then time. Is so early in the list because a system which has no awareness of time passing is essentially something that we are not using and we don't find of any usage. I mean, any system for its behavior and its evolution has to have a notion of time. Which kind of time and how is measured, it's another problem, but still time is something that must be there as a concept. Data and state, the data and information which are exchanged, and the state of a system of system, actions and behavior, communications, interfaces, this is again a very important concept. Professor Kopetz, I don't know whether you heard about Professor Kopetz, he's a quite big guy, and very, very, I mean, I did like a lot to work with him. He claims that designing a system is actually designing the interfaces. If you make a good design of the interfaces, then the components which interact through these interfaces are peanuts. The difficult and critical part is to define proper interfaces among the different components. Evolution and dynamicity, where we think dynamicity as the ability to react to short-term changes, while evolution is the ability to, let's say, undergo long-term changes, that means evolution, evolve. System design and tools. Okay, clearly we need to have some help and some tools for doing this. Dependability and security. as we said, we have to rely on these on their behavior. So we need to have some make some claim that things are working. And finally, but if you see, is bold emergence. Okay, which is a very important concept in this respect. Okay, the figure over there relates to data and information. If I exchange the data which is on the floor, doesn't mean that I exchange the same information. First guy thinks M, second guy thinks W. Like famous disasters in which someone gave an information in feet and someone else got it in meters and crashed. Okay, so flow of data and flow of information is again something that we have to account for. Emergence. This is the definition, and then we take. We said a system of system is the integration of existing subsystems or new. I mean, but I prepare the subsystem and then I integrate everything together. So it's a plurality of interacting subsystems. And here we claim also that the system of system is not just the sum of its components. And here we have the definition. We see later a lot about that. Emergence is a phenomenon of the whole at the macro level. So when I see the thing as a unique thing, is a phenomenon of the whole, which is emergent if and only if it is of a new kind with respect to the non-relational phenomena of any of its proper parts at the micro level. I have emergence when, if I look the parts, I have to describe these parts, concept and laws, which are of one kind, and when I take the whole, I need to discuss or to talk on something different. Just to make me understand, and we will take later, say, in computer science, we had several phenomena of this type, okay? You know that when you make distributed or concurrent programs, you may have to write semaphores. Okay, so sections in which only one process can go and so on. And you can write these things making, say, entering a semaphore, operating on a shared data, and then exiting the semaphore. I think, or raise your hands, whoever heard about deadlock. Okay, deadlock is an emergent phenomenon. If you look at the individual processes, you don't even know what is deadlock. When you put some processes together, depending on the interactions they have, you may have deadlock. Okay, so the whole is the system, the parts are the individual processes, and the emergent phenomena is the deadlock. And we can have, I will make you different examples in which this will become very, very clear. And this is also the reason why we design system of systems. Because we want something which is more than what we can get by an individual system. Otherwise, we would not take the burden to make this complex stuff if it was not for something that otherwise we are not able to built. Okay? So emergent properties is exactly our purpose in designing systems of systems. Because if they were properties that we could find in the components, we use the components only, no problems. But emergent phenomena can be beneficial, and this is exactly our goal, or detrimental, like the deadlock. When we design a concurrent system, we want all the processes together can do something more valuable than any single process alone. But we may have also bad phenomena that impair the stuff. They can be expected or unexpected. Sometimes it's a surprise, sometimes, if I design concurrent processes without taking particular care, I can expect that a deadlock may happen. So they can be expected in a sense, or not. So especially if you talk on the point of view of proper working of a system of system, these bad emergence phenomena are a sort of a problem. Yes. Usually you transform in requirement. Why not? Why? Yes, you can. Because sometimes when you say in your system that you want a property, but then you may not have components which are able to provide you immediately this property, and you manage to get the property through a proper interaction of subcomponent. For example, suppose you say you want a global time base, a reliable global time base. A distributed algorithm for clock synchronization is providing to you this. If you take the clock on the individual component, they are each of them. You want a system-wide notion of global time. You make a distributed clock synchronization algorithm, and you know that each correct clock has a representation of the global time, and so on and so forth. So sometimes you put it as a requirement, and you design for it. And this is exactly what's a system of system for, because you want something that you don't have already, and then you try to design the system of system and the components and their interaction in such a way that you reach this property. Is our goal. Okay, sure. Let's say you want the property. In this case, you speak more of a property than a requirement, even though a property can be transformed in a requirement. But you think positively to the property, and then your business will be to have components interacting in such a way that you can bring the satisfaction of the requirement. And beware, this is exactly why we think of systems. Because if it was possible to reach the same services or the same goal or the same objective through what we already have, no point in taking all this challenge. Right. But sometimes emergence can be very negative. Can lead you to the deadlock or can lead you to serious disasters. Okay, a wrong interactions among components, something that you didn't forecast before but can happen, so you trace a set of events which lead to a major failure. And this, okay. And in fact, managing emergence is absolutely important, because we would like to avoid undesired bad emergence, unexpected emergence, negative side. And on the other side, this is exactly our purpose for, let's say, the conception of the system itself. This finished, say, the basic introduction. Now we can, I will give you some of our definitions. We can also discuss some of them if you are not convinced, or if you want to propose different models, and we see if they are really different. So first definition is domain. The domain comprises the set of entities and the relationship among the entities that are of interest when modeling the selected view. I mean, we have to restrict the universe, because otherwise it becomes impossible to reason. And to structure the domain, we must identify object in this domain, a distinct and self-contained existence. So let's start. Entity. Entity is something that exists as a distinct and a self-contained unit. Can be a thing. So a thing is a physical entity that has an identifiable existence in the physical world. This is a thing. A construct is a non-physical entity, is a product of a human mind, like an idea. It's still an entity, but is immaterial. Okay, we have these two kind of entities. What is a system? System is an entity. So, not saying whether it is physical or not, is an entity that is capable of interacting with its environment and may be sensitive to the progression of time. Something which is not able to interact with its environment is a stone. It's not a system, right? May be sensitive to the progression of time. In some cases it is not, but in most cases it is. So, a system may react differently to the same pattern of input activity, and this depends from the environment and also of the time. Okay, so it's not a function. A system is something that can have memory of the past and so react in different way. What is the environment? Because in giving the definition of the system, I said it's capable of interacting with its environment. Environment are the entities and their actions in the domain that are not part of the system but have the capability to interact with the system. So it's essentially everything which is capable to interact with the system. You see a system and its environment in the figure. System and environment are separated by a system boundary, a dividing line between two systems or between a system and the environment. So defining a system allows us to define the boundary of the system. And what is outside is its environment, which can be other systems or real world. System architecture. System architecture we define as the blueprint of a design that establishes the overall structure, the major building blocks, and the interactions among these major building blocks and the environment. Okay, and if you consider, when designing a system, each organization follow a set of implicit or explicit rules and conventions, naming convention, representation of data, protocols. Okay. you take systems developed by an entity, you can retrieve that these things are essentially constant. So they are their architectural style. Say, then the architectures are different, but these things are unifying and they are. But anyway, the architecture is the blueprint of a design. It's not a specific. The boundary in system of system is not as easy as the boundary for a system. Also because the system boundary can change very dynamically in time. Say, this car-to-car system of system. You have a system of system which many cars can interact to each other by exchanging data, exchanging messages, coordinating in a way. Here you have a bus and two cars and another car part. But say, is the red car part of the system of system or not? And in a few seconds, when the bus will be far apart from the two cars, what will be the system of system? And where is the boundary? Okay? So in a system of system, the boundary is changing continuously. So it's no more so easy to define the boundary as it is for a system. Autonomous systems. In this example that we have just taken, each individual car in the system consists of the mechanics of the car, so the physical part, the control system, so all the software that Daimler puts in his cars, and the driver. And we can consider this an autonomous system. Because if I get on my car and I want to drive home, this system has its own objective and all the means to reach it. So in this sense, it's an autonomous system which is performing its mission. Okay? Because I want to reach to the concept of autonomous system. An autonomous system is a system that can provide its service without guidance by another system. No one is telecommanding my car. I'm driving my car and I go home, and I go around. I have my mission and I am able to perform it. In this sense, I am an autonomous system. I'm not controlled by another system. Let's come again to cyber physical systems. We have already given the definition in the bottom part of the slides, but now we can also see that in many cases we see systems which are composed of autonomous interrelated parts. Traffic is composed of autonomous cars. Each of them is hierarchical in structure until we reach the component level. So we start with our hierarchy and we go there, and at some point we have autonomy. So here now it's important for us to define the concept of constituent system. A constituent system is an autonomous subsystem of a system of system, consisting again of a computer, possibly a controlled object, and or a human. Okay. So an autonomous system, a constituent system, can be a cyber physical system, but is a part of a system of system. The important thing is that it is autonomous. So it's not guided by an external control. It's not dominated by an external control acting as a, say, incomplete guidance, but is doing, is achieving his mission and is able to do that. Then he may be able also to interact with other system for doing even better. Say, if I imagine that I have traffic information, okay, car-to-car information flowing, which tells me that in 1 kilometer there will be a traffic jam, in order to reach my goal, I can also deviate from what was my original mission. And this is obviously some benefit of the system of system concept. So I voluntarily modify my behavior because of the interactions with the others. But still, I am an autonomous. I'm not told exactly what to do. And we come again to the definition which was given by Jamsidi of a system of system. An SOS is the integration or an integration of a finite number of constituent systems which are independent and operable and which are networked together for a period of time. So not forever, for a period of time, to achieve a higher level goal. Clearly, and this definition requires some thinking or some explanation. So we have an integration. So we are putting together parts, a finite number of parts, not an infinite number of parts. Okay. And these constituent systems are independent and operable. So each of them could achieve his mission, his goals, and he is completely able and he is independent in a sense. They are put together, networked together for a limited amount of time. Okay. Not necessarily forever. We have a duration of this interconnection. And why are they put together? To achieve some higher level goal. To achieve goals that each individual system cannot achieve alone. Commenta. Why? Sure. They are not completely autonomous in a sense that their behavior is constrained. But Fatima, when you are in a traffic jam, you are constrained, even if you are an autonomous system, because you cannot drive over the other cars. So you are constrained. If a car comes behind you, even if you want to move to the left, you have to wait. So your behavior, saying that you are an autonomous system doesn't mean that your behavior cannot be constrained by the environment that you have around. I mean, you accepted the concept of a set of cars being a system of system, okay? And you accepted the concept that each car is operable because each of us wants to go home driving. But when we are all on the highway and we have a traffic jam, we are not completely free to move as we wish. We have rules to obey. The fact that you are autonomous doesn't mean that you have to obey some rules and that you have some constraint in your behavior. Okay? So this is, we will touch this because clearly when you join a system of system, clearly the ensemble is putting some constraint on each individual system. This is in physics is in the real world is very evident, right? You are a car, you are in the street, you are autonomous, but you have to obey the rules of driving. If there is a speed limit, you are supposed to obey the speed limit, even if you want to get home early. If you take the entire infrastructure, these systems are operable and autonomous, but they are, in a sense, in order to join the system of system, they have to obey some of the rules. Okay, and maybe thinking to your application setup, if you take the satellite alone, is living his life around the orbit. If no one sends data to get back, still is there. Then you want to achieve higher goal that with only the satellite you cannot achieve. But still, that system is there and is operable on its own, as well as the appliances that you have to collect data. They are there, they collect data, they are on, they send the data, they may don't care whether someone is getting this data or not. This is what they do. And then you orchestrate all together this thing. Okay, but probably the entire the component is not the satellite alone, but is the satellite and the ground station. Yeah. Exactly. Okay, so it depends. We have to understand the granularity of the constituent system in your case, but if you take the ground station and the satellite, they are operable and they can do what they want. Then you want a higher goal, which is getting some data and process some data and make available the synthesis of some data. And for that, you need other systems and you have to coordinate some of these things. And this you are achieving with a system of system. Hey. Molto bene. And also, you can see that at least it was boundaries are defined for a period of time. There was in the literature the distinction of different forms of systems of systems. Okay, say directed systems of system is a system of system with a central managed purpose and central ownership. For example, the set of control system in a car. They belong to the same organization and they are very strict. They have this mission and so on. Acknowledged. It's independent ownership, but there are cooperative agreements among the owners to a specific aligned purposes. Take the train network in Europe. You have, as a system of system, the ground segments, say, the trains. They belong to different organizations. They are Italian, French, German trains, and as well as the different infrastructures. But there are conventions and the standards, and each of them has to obey and to be conformant to this standard. And say it's the objective is fixed. Still, each train company works for the benefit of the company and of that train. Okay. But has, let's say, if you want to participate to the system, you have to obey a given set of rules and so on. Then you have a different, again, degree of freedom. Voluntary interaction of independent constituent systems to achieve a goal that is not a unified goal, but is specific to the individual system. I cooperate for my own, for improving my own earnings or benefit. Say, a set of cars which are available to provide information on the traffic. I participate voluntarily because if I want to switch off, I can switch off. If I switch on, I can have a benefit because I provide information, other people provide information to me, and I can avoid some traffic jam or else. It's still for my benefit. Virtual, lack of central purpose of central alignment. You can take this as the set of the ATM around the world. What is the purpose? To provide you money when you are not in Brazil or we are not home? Not sure that this is the real purpose. Is one effect true? And again, the banks or the entities who join this system, they join for their exclusive benefit. There is no common objective in that. Even there are examples of systems of system in which the owners of different parts are not so friendly to each other. They join the system of system, but with very opposite goals. Okay, especially if you go to some defense systems or these kind of things, you can imagine. We are all friends, but Frau Merkel is not feels Americans very friendly after they put under control everything in Germany. Okay, still, they are in a system of system together. So these four, they were proposed in the literature, and they are different categories from very strict and fixed relationship among the constituent system until really the very, very broad kind of links. And in between, you have all the possible levels. Is it time for stopping 10 minutes or not yet? Okay. Let's stop a few minutes.
this way.
Hello? 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 This way it works. Yeah. Okay.
I will show you if you just put it here and put.
And I need an ice cream. Okay? Hello? Hello, 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 hello. Works, 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 works. Okay. It's okay. Yes. I think so. Is it okay?
Yeah.
Volume.
Maybe just stay there because it's so no.
So now we have everybody here, so we can start. So we went through some of the basic concepts, and now we deal a bit with time. Notion of time. Okay. In the system of system paradigm, we are concerned with changes. Okay, evolution, long-term view, and so on. And all this depends on the progression of time, right? Why do we need a global notion of time? I mean, it's not enough for us that each single component has its own notion of time. If each component has its clock, but the clock are not synchronized together, all of them, we cannot do a lot of important things. For example, the whole timestamp concept has no more value. I mean, a timestamp, which means I put the time of a message when I send the message, and the receiver can see whether the message is old or fresh enough, makes sense only based on the assumption that the two clocks are synchronized. Otherwise, it's no information. We have real-time control data. For example, if I drive and at a given point in time I see a traffic light which is green, and then I shut my eyes, how long is this information valid? Can you tell? You should be able to tell. Well, for example, in Italy we have three colors. We have green, and then we have yellow, and then we have red. And the yellow duration is normally 7 seconds. So if I see a semaphore which is green, I can say that for at least 7 seconds it will be again green, still green. You see? Okay, but in many systems you have a concept of validity, real-time validity of the data. A data is valid for a given amount of time, no more than that. And if you don't have synchronized clock, you cannot assess this validity. Synchronize input and output. This is clear and self-explaining. Conflict-free resource allocation. How can I allocate resources to the different components or system if we don't share the notion of time? This is impossible. Error detection. If I have proper clocks with the timestamps or with other mechanism, I can detect errors. If I don't, in time-free systems, detecting error is almost impossible. Security protocols. Also security protocol, if I have a notion of global time, can be synchronized and so on. Say, most of the system change automatically, most of the bank system change automatically the passwords. You are given a small machine which changes numbers every 30 seconds, and when you make an operation, you are asked to type the number which is on this small device. But this is possible only if there is a synchronization between the device and the central office in order for the office to wait to expect exactly that code. If it changes every 30 seconds, they must be synchronized that way. Otherwise, you can never know whether the number is correct or not. And many other security protocols work on this basis. What is time? Time is a continuous, measurable, physical quantity in which events occur in a sequence proceeding from the past to the present and to the future. So it is a unidirectional, continuous line. Okay, this is important. So the timeline is a dense line denoting the independent progression of time. Time progresses independently or against sometime our will. This, I start feeling. And we have instants, which an instant is a cut in the timeline, so has no duration, it's just a cut, and events which are happenings, something which happens in an instant. Again, an event has no duration. Then we have, if we talk about time, cycles. The cycle is a temporal sequence of events that reaches a final state, cyclic control. You remember, you have a sequence of events, you reach an end, you have a final state, and then you can repeat this cycle, restart the sequence. This is cyclic executive. I mean, some of the first scheduling stuff was made just by cyclic execution of some programs. Okay. Well, the duration of each cycle, if we measure in physical time, can change. So one cycle can be different from the previous or for the next. But still, the fact that it is a cycle helps us in making, say, having this notion of time passing. What is that? Push the wrong button. And then we have periodic systems, which is not only cyclic. Periodic systems are cyclic systems in which the cycle has a constant duration. For example, many control systems are cyclic with a constant duration of the cycle, because you have to sample your input data, process, and act on the actuators within the time limit given by the application, and you define the cycle based on this limit. Clearly, when we have periodic system, we can structure in a very easy way every problem of control. Okay, control system. It's easy to build a control system if we use periods. In fact, periodicity is not a must, but whenever we can do, we can simplify a lot the problem of the design of our system. Time standard, here I don't say anything new to you. Okay, and there are a few standards. UTC, TAI, GPS is distributing this time. So UTC is the astronomical time standard, but we have the problem, at least in computer science, we have the problem of the leap second. So TAI is used with preference. TAI stands for Temps Atomique International, has the duration of the second. Did I report there? Well, it's an atomic frequency. And then there was the decision to start TAI January 1st, 1958. And say, the way GPS is providing the TAI timing information is, through weeks and full seconds within a week in this period, and every 1K weeks, they restart again. So every 19.6 years, the cycles repeat, but it's considered long enough. And this information is distributed by GPS. And I don't know whether Galileo or the GLONASS distribute the same TAI. I think so. It should be stupid not to do it. But is the time that we have available essentially for a really huge system of system, when we say that we need to have a global time, the source of the time must be TAI. Okay. And then we have clocks. Because one thing is the concept of time, which is passing in the line unidirectional with events and so on. We have this definition of TAI, but then we need machines able to measure time. I said time is a measurable information. So we need something which is able to measure time. And this is a different problem. So clock are the machines that we use to measure time. Okay. Is an autonomous system, a clock, has an oscillator and a counter. And a register which is used as a counter. When the oscillator completes a period, we have a tick. I mean, the counter is increased by one, and this is the tick of the clock. We need, or for our reasoning is easier if we make the assumption or we think the concept of a reference clock. A reference clock is an hypothetical clock, so doesn't exist in reality. The granularity of the clock is smaller than any duration of interest, so has ticks which are very frequent. Not every second or millisecond, but they are frequent than any, more frequent than any duration of interest. What does it mean? That we can measure any duration in terms of a number of clock ticks of the reference clock. So if my clock has a granularity of 1 hour, I cannot measure things which last for 10 minutes because they will be always at noon. So in order to measure something, I need a clock in which the granularity is smaller than the duration of this something. And the smaller the duration, the more precise is my measurement. But sometimes it's very difficult to have clocks with this small granularity. Still, for our reasoning, we make the assumptions that we have a clock, the reference clock, which has a granularity smaller than any event of interest, not only, and is always in agreement with time. Okay, we make also other assumption. Small granularity. The reference clock also can observe any event of interest without any delay. So we are neglecting relativistic issues. Okay, the clock perceives events exactly when they happen, with no delay, no anything. And the state is always according to time. Is God clock. Okay? Perfect and always in alignment and knows everything exactly in the moment it happens, and we can measure everything. So we can take it as a reference clock to compare the things that we poor humans can do, can build, because a clock is a machine and we can build this machine. We say that a coordinated clock is a clock synchronized within some stated limits to a reference clock, which is spatially separated from it. So I have a remote clock and I try to coordinate to that clock. In reality, what happens is that we have the notion of this reference clock distributed by GPS, and we we correct our clocks, we discipline our clocks based on this source that is coming, which are all then approximation of the reference clock. Clocks have a drift. As I said, a physical clock is an oscillator and a register, a counter. So, in principle, every oscillation, I have a tick. The problem is that the tick of the clock does not measure time exactly in a correct way, exactly as it time passes. What happens in reality is that there is a ratio between the physical clock and the reference clock. While the reference clock is progressing correctly, a physical clock can progress more or less than the reference clock. And we call this ratio drift. Okay, so a clock has a drift, means that in the long term it's going to diverge from the reference clock, like our watches if we don't correct them ever. Then we have, say, good clocks with today's technology have drift rates around 10 to the minus 6. 10 to the minus 4 is not a good one. 10 to the minus 5, 10 to the minus 6 are good clocks. What does it mean? That my clock can make 1 second more or less every 1 million of seconds. Okay? But still, if I don't do anything and my system lasts and has to work for years, at the end, the time measured by my clock will be sufficiently different from the reference clock to give problems. So we need to correct this clock. Okay, I have it in the, say, more expanded set of slides on clocks, but what happens is that we have to correct the clocks of our physical things periodically in order to avoid that they diverge. Okay. What we try to do is to make them all close enough to the reference clock. And then if I can prove that my clock is never farther from the GPS clock than 1 microsecond, and this holds for all the clocks in my system of system, I can say that any two clocks are closer than 2 microseconds. Okay? And this gives a bound on the difference between clocks, which is then used in all the protocols and every situation in which we need to manage time. But we need to build this global time base. Global time base will be that the correctly working clocks, and so components, are all within a range around the reference clock. If we take a granularity, this is an anticipation, if we take a granularity higher than this precision, then we have a global clock which we can use for measuring any events in the system of system. And this is quite an important property. But we will come to this again. Data and state. It's clear now, so far, that we think at systems of systems as constituent components interacting each other. So there are transfers of information among these constituent systems. Because if everything is about the interaction is not just synchronization, it's also bringing data back and forth. What is information? What is the relation between information and data? These are clearly very important questions. Because if we are clear on defining what is information and how information can be represented by data, then we can, say, set up the sufficient measures to avoid problems like sending inches and understanding meters. Okay? Because the data, a data item is an artifact, is a pattern of bit at the end. I send you a packet, is 1,500 bits. What is inside? How should I interpret what is inside? Okay. So we need really to understand how to interpret bit patterns. On the other side, if you think at information, from a logical viewpoint, information is nothing else than a proposition about the state or an action in the world. Okay, so it's a completely different abstraction layer than data. Data is a bit pattern, information is a statement on something. So we have to translate correctly the statement on this something into a big pattern, explaining how we code it in such a way that when this information is taken somewhere else, the guy who has to consume the information must have also an explanation on how to interpret this data. So a correct transformation of data is that I transfer the bit pattern, but the bit pattern must contain also an explanation on how to interpret the data. Okay, this is quite important. Then receivers can be human or machines, and again the explanation must describe how the data must be used, and there may be differences if the consumer is a human or if the consumer is a machine. Because in case it is a human, okay, we have to describe the data using concepts that are familiar to the human receiver. If it is a machine, the data have to be interpreted by machine instruction. Okay. And the explanation, again, must be directed to the humans which have written or which have to write the code which interpret the data. But there are, as I say, some differences. The state. So again, system has a behavior which depends on its interaction with the environment. You remember that when we defined the system, we said it's an entity which is capable to interact with the environment and may have also a notion of time. This is what we said. The important thing is that can have or must have interactions with the environment. So the state of the system, of a system at some point in time, is the totality of the information from the past that can have an influence on the future behavior of the system. When my behavior does not depend from past information, I perform a function. Okay. I don't need to remember the much information from the past. If my behavior depends on other information from the past, then I have a notion of state. For the electronics, you can think to the combinatorial logic or automaton. Okay. Automaton have a state and they remember what the relevant thing in the past, while a combinatorial circuit performs also always the same thing and does not, for Markovian processes, they don't need to remember anything from the past. But again, as I said, the state is the collection of all the information from the past that are relevant for the future behavior. In general, is a data structure, huge one, and we state that the concept of state is meaningless without a concept of time. So I have a state in a given time, because I have the notion of the past and the future. Okay. Take the definition, is the collection of all the information from the past which may have an impact on the future behavior. So I need to fix a cut in the timeline and say what is the past and what is the future. In this sense, I have a notion of time. Otherwise, there's no There's no meaning to that. So the state space of a system is the totality of all possible value of the state variables within a domain and can be very huge. Actions and behavior. Actions. We can have an event-based view. Okay. Let's take a system and observe its dynamics, its behavior. The system, say, is represented by discrete variables and can have a state, an event-based view or a state-based view. What is the difference? That in event-based view, we observe the value of the relevant state variables at the beginning of the observation. We record all the events. What is an event here? Is a change in the state of some variable. Okay, observe the time or occurrence of the event in a trace. We can build a trace of the history of all these changes. And the value of all state variables at any past instant is defined by the trace that we record. We start from an initial state, we record all the events, they are modifications to the variable, and we can reconstruct the state of the system at any point in time. For this, we have a problem. The problem is that the number of events that can happen is not bounded. An event can happen in a point in time, has no duration, so we can have as many as we can think. The number is not bounded. Well, this means that the amount of data that we should generate is not bounded. Because we said we construct a trace. For each event, we add something to the trace. If the number of events is unbounded, the size of the trace is unbounded. So we are at risk, say. Our concept will work as long as we don't have too many events. Then we can cope and we can manage. But there's nothing which guarantees us that, say, things will work. Because if at some point the amount, the number of events will become too big, we'll not be able. State-based view. How can we solve this problem? Well, we downsize our expectations. Okay. We downsize our expectation by using a state-based view, which means that we make a periodic view of the state. So we observe the value of the state-based variable in selected observation instance. We define sampling points. Okay, now, in an hour, in 2 hours, once per hour, I go and say and take a picture of the system state. Okay, I'm not recording everything which happens, but I'm just taking samples at prescribed point in times. Then what happens? That I can fix the sampling interval. Okay. What is a proper sampling interval? Sampling interval is proper if I can make relatively frequent samples so that I don't lose too much, and still the amount of data and the work I have to do is manageable. So I should push this to the limit of my capability. If I can manage to have 1,000 observations per second or 2000, I should go with 2000. Okay, but I fix a limit in the amount of processing and of data that I have to manage. The price is that if events happen between two sample events, it's like if I make a picture of you and then I make a picture of you in a second and again. So those changes which permain between one picture and the next, I can record and trace. If someone changes and comes back between two pictures, I cannot get aware of this movement. But if I do this way, I lose some information, but I can manage, because the amount of modifications of processing is fixed, is limited. In the other way, I record everything until I possible. Previous model, there is the fragility that I cannot bound the amount of work I have to do. In this, there is the limit that I may lose some of the information because they happen in between two sample point. Okay. Execution time. Execution time is the time needed to execute something, to execute a specific action. And it depends on the performance of the hardware that I have available, dependent on the data. If you run the same program on different data, the execution time may be different. Okay, and so on. We have a nice concept of worst case execution time, WSET. Okay, is the worst case, which should be data independent, and this has to be taken as the upper bound for executing a given action. If I can allocate this maximum time and I can reason on my system that this action will take this maximum time, I am on the safe size, on the safe side, okay? Because in case it takes shorter. So it is a very important issue, the one of defining and being able to determine what is the worst case execution time for some action in real-time computers. This is the assumption under which we can prove that the system is working. And then we have to decide when to start this action. Okay. Because the worst case execution time tells us the duration of executing an action, and then we have to set when the action has to start. So we have two possible starting guns. Okay, one is time triggered action. The start signal is derived by the clock, by the time. At noon, you should do something. At noon, I start the action to do something. If I have a proper clock, at noon, this will start. Or event triggered, an action which is started when an event happens. I receive some packet, some data, signal on the network, and then I will start reacting to this event. Okay? It's two different choices that we have, and there were long debates in the community of real-time systems on whether one was better than the other. Okay, I attended several panels in which people were almost fighting to say this is better and the other is better. Actually, both of them have pros and cons. Behavior is what we are really interested in. Am I right? I see a system, I want to see how it behaves. So we have a function, which is a mapping from input to output data. And then we have a behavior, which is a timed sequence of the effects of input and output actions. It can be observed at the interface of a system. If I put myself at the interface of a system and I say, what is his behavior? Well, I start observing its a sequence of actions that it does a long time, both in input and output. A writing action or producing output action have observable effect. If I command an actuator or I send an output, this can be observed outside at the boundary of my system. We can talk about deterministic behavior. We like deterministic systems more than the others. A deterministic system is such that if we give an initial state at a given time and a set of future input, again timed, a sequence in time of the inputs, the future state, the values, and the instant of all outputs are at that point foreseeable and entailed. Okay? If a system is deterministic, if I have an initial state at some time and I can say when the input will be offered to the system, then I can derive all the internal state and the outputs that the system will be, because it's deterministic. And again, a system can have an intended behavior or also do something which we call erroneous. Should be called different from what we intend. Since we are judging, we say it's erroneous then. And again, we define as the service of a system the intended behavior of a system. System is providing good service means that the system is behaving as we intended the system to behave. And if it is a deterministic system, it is doing exactly what we have forecast because we could make all this provision. Communication. Well, communication system has a very precise mission, as to transport messages from a sender to one or more receivers. Okay, here I'm general. The sender is sending a message. I'm not limiting or dividing the case that there is one single receiver or many. One or more receiver, but within a given duration, and with the high, hopefully high, dependability. What does it mean? That a communication system, if I want to send a message, I want my message to arrive in some bounded time, and I want my message to arrive, and to arrive correct. Say 51 must arrive, not 50. Well, high dependability, okay, we mean that by the end of the time interval that we set, the message must have arrived with a very high probability. The message is not corrupted, neither intentionally or by some error, occasional error. Intentional or unintentional. The security of the message is not being compromised. If it is a secret, it must arrive as a secret, so no one has to be able to see what was sent. And we may have also additional constraints beside this. Okay. For sure, we allocate some time, maximum time. By the end of this time window, we want the message to be there with very high probability, to be there exactly as it was sent, and if there was a secret, that the secret is still a secret. We may also want to spend less energy possible, especially if we talk of small devices with limited energy capability. We want also, we may want to minimize that. Communication protocol is the set of rules that govern a communication action. Okay, when I have a communication system, the entities which are meant to communicate must follow rules on sending and receiving that we call describe how actions have to be made. A message is a data structure formed by the purpose of being sent over, so to allow a timely exchange of information. Okay, I built a message to exchange information. Again, in a message we combine the value domain and the temporal domain. We can put timestamps on it. And the most famous form of message is the datagram. Okay. The datagram is a best effort message for the transmission of sporadic information. I don't know when I will have to send something. Whenever I have to send, I form this message and I send a datagram. Then we may have more sophisticated forms of communication. The PAR message, which is a positive acknowledgement or retransmission. I mean, for those who are familiar with a bit of network, a datagram is really a UDP packet. Okay. You send. But then we can do also positive acknowledgement or retransmission. So I want to control the errors. Why or how? I send sporadic message. Okay, still I'm not having a regular transmission. I send message whenever I need. But I wait for a positive acknowledgement. So the receiver sends me back, hey, I got your message. At that point, I'm sure that the message was there. The receiver got the message. If I don't get this acknowledgement, I send the message again. So I allocate a time window, and by that time window, either I get the acknowledgement message or I send the message again. If I repeat this forever, sooner or later the message will arrive, or I know that the message didn't arrive. Okay, so sometimes knowledge, even negative knowledge, is for further action. This is a different form of communication. And last, we have time-triggered message, which is a transport service which is meant for periodic messages. I need to send a message every second. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then, from one sender to many receiver, and the send instant is derived by progression of time. At the beginning of each second, I send a message. If we compare these three ways, we can derive some characteristics. Okay, send instant. For datagram and the positive acknowledgement is sporadic, because I send message when I for the time triggered, it's periodic. I need to define the period, and every period I send a message. Okay. Control flow datagram is unidirectional. Information is flowing from sender and receiver, full stop. In positive acknowledgement, the information is bidirectional, because the information goes from sender to receiver, but the acknowledgement is going from receiver to sender. So there is also some information going back related to the reception of the message. In time triggered, it is again unidirectional, because I send message every second, and the receiver is not acting or sending any message back. Control flow. Well, in the first case, it's not existing. There's no control. Because I send the datagram message, hope for the best, and that's it. In the second case, we have an explicit control, because the receiver is explicitly sending an acknowledgement. So the control on the good transmission of the data message is confirmed by the explicitly confirmed by the receiver. In the TT message is again implicit, because I can make a control flow. So if I am a receiver and I know that every second Fatima has to send a message, every second I wait for this message. If the message doesn't come, I am aware of something wrong. So there's a control around, but it's implicit. It's not done through exchanging additional messages. Message handling, okay, read, write, copy and paste. Transport duration. In the datagram, I cannot make any statement on how long the message will take to get to the other side. No means for checking that. In positive acknowledgement, I have an upper limit, because when I set my time window to resend the message, okay, means that if I receive a knock, I can measure how much, I can make an upper bound of how much it took for the message to go the other side. In time triggered, this is Hermann Kopetz writing tight limit known, because the assumption is that if I can transmit the variation on the media is very small. So if I just have to take the time of transmission on the media, then I can make assumption that the time is smaller. Jitter. You know what is jitter? Jitter is the variance of the delay. If I send a set of message, they can say take in average 1 second to reach my destination, in average. But they will not take each of them 1 second. Some will take less and some will take more. And in some cases, the difference is important, and it's important also to know how much it is. And this is jitter, is the difference in the transmission time from one message to the next. Okay. And essentially, for the datagram, we don't know. We send a message which may arrive in a millisecond, and we can send another message which can take a second. Technologically, it may not happen, but on the control side, no. In positive acknowledgement, still the jitter can be large. I mean, we have an upper bound on the transmission, so the variability is bounded somehow, but is large, while in TT message the jitter is very small. Because I send the message every second, and so the difference is just transmission on the media, which may be a fraction longer or smaller, but is not really very significant. Temporal error detection. The error detection in doesn't send the datagram and there's no information, back information. For PAR messages, I have a temporal error detection at the sender. Because the sender knows if I had an error because does not receive the acknowledgement. Okay? The receiver either doesn't receive the message at all, so how can he say there's an error, or sends the acknowledgement, but the acknowledgement got lost. And again, has no information about. While the sender, if does not receive the acknowledgement, knows that something went wrong. So the error detection is made by the sender. For TT message, the error detection is made by the receiver. Again, I expect to receive a message at that time. If I don't receive, I know that there was an error. So it is the receiver which does know. Technologically, these are UDP, TCP, the positive acknowledgement, and the time-triggered Ethernet used in a TDMA configuration for the TT messages. Stigmergy. This is far more important as a concept than what we said so far on communication. Constituent systems that form our system of system, we said, can exchange information, through different ways. Okay? Essentially two types of channels. First is conventional communication channel for the transport of messages. Exactly what we said just now, an Ethernet network, a wireless network, a cyber network. Okay, the full internet. But, so, a car sends a message to another car saying, look, I am overcoming, or I'm steering, or whatever. But, there are also physical channels that we call the stigmergic channel that transport information through the change and the observation of the environment. Look, when you drive your car and you see the car in front of you that at some point blinks on the right, what do you think? That is going to turn right. But he didn't send you a message, an Ethernet message, or still he wanted to provide you information. So the information between two cars, in this case, has been transferred because one car modified the environment in the sense that opened the lamp. And the car behind, you are part of the car in this example, saw this modification of the environment and interpreted correctly as an information. Okay. So exchange of information between constituent system in cyber physical systems of system can happen not only through explicit cyber messages, but also through one system modifying the environment and the other systems looking, watching these modifications. I see that something changed, and this can be just, well, something changed, or can be information, and can be intentional, like in this example that we made, and can be also be unintentional. Maybe I did want to act on something, but my main purpose was not to communicate to others anything. Simply, I wanted to do that action. Okay? If I pass in the evening outside Fatima's house, she has the light on, not because she wants to communicate to me that I'm outside, look, I'm at home, but for other purposes. Still, if I pass by there, I can get information by looking at the physical environment. Okay? And this is important. It's very important. Let me see what. So Stigmer G, we still stole the word by biology. The stigmergic phenomena are those of ants constructing path. And the communication where the food is between an ant and the other is through chemical substances that they put in the ground, and then you see all these row of ants. Why ants are moving, following specific path or in column? Because there is chemicals which some ants put down to signal to the others that there was food, and all the other colony then following to bring the food back. And when food is finished, they stop putting this substance in the ground, and slowly it vanishes, and there's no more path. So it's even in biology, communication happens through modification of the environment, but also for us. I mean, if you go explore something, I go to walk in the mountains. And there are all the paths with a number and the red signs, and from every 200 meters you see a path. Okay, this is something that someone put there to give some information. And when I follow a path, I get this information. Okay, why this is important? Because if we talk only of cyber classical systems, cyber system interact via cyber channels. And we can have all the messages and try to understand the interactions just looking the messages. When we talk of cyber physical systems, since they have this physical dimension, their interaction, their exchange of information can happen both through cyber messages, but also with these physical, stigmergic channels. And sometimes if we don't care enough of the cyber, of the stigmergic channel, of the physical flow of information, we are not able to reconstruct all the interactions and the causal loops among these systems. Okay? If you see the traffic, you have plenty of these physical signs, a traffic light. In the future, when all cars will be completely automated, you will not have any more traffic lights. You will have machines which will communicate explicitly to the cars which one has to pass and which one has not. Now we have the lights, and the lights provide information through this environment modification. Okay, so this is really important to understand and to consider that we have to trace communication channels not only on protocols and networks, but also on physical environment in which two constituent systems can join. Okay, this is the answer. I already explained you this phenomena. This is described better. The additional information which you can find here is that there is also some environmental dynamics. What does it mean? Is that the environment by itself can or tends to modify things. Okay, so in this case, the pheromone evaporates. And after some time, there's no more sign of pheromone and no ant can perceive anything. So ants have to keep putting pheromone in if they want the path following. But the environment is acting on this channel. Because the pheromone distributed on a path constitutes a channel. And the environment is acting to cancel this. If tomorrow I go on the beach, I can take something and write something on the sand. If someone passes close to time when I write, can still read, type, will come and cancel everything. Or I can imagine that in the sky there can be phenomena similar to this. The rumors, noise, which is acting to cancel some or to modify some information. Interfaces. So, interfaces, you can imagine, is another very important point, because we have been discussing for long now of constituent system interacting to each other and on their integration to become a system of systems. We are integrating systems, and obviously, if I want to integrate system and let them communicate, I need to define, specify, and build interfaces. Because otherwise, there's no point or there's no possibility. What is an interface? Interfaces are point of interaction between the systems and the systems and the environment over time, since we are including also this physical stuff. Okay. A channel, a communication channel, in reality, is a linkage between two interfaces. I can establish a communication channel if the two systems have proper interfaces and can be connected. Two interfaces can be the eyes and my hands to move the traffic light, the sign to turn. Still, there is the need of interfaces. So an interaction is an exchange of information at connected interfaces. So a channel is a logical or physical link that transports information among systems at their connected interfaces. For example, you can easily imagine two systems which are communicating through the environment, because one has an actuator and the other has a sensor. The sensor and the actuator are the interfaces, and they are specified, and you know that the sensor can be of some part or some way or made in some other way, able to do something or not, and so on. Okay, so you have specification of these interfaces, and then a channel is the connections between these two interfaces. A channel can be implemented by a communication system, so computer network or physical transmission, can affect the information transported. For example, introducing uncertainties. We have, depending on the transmission media, bit error rates and everything else. So a channel can somehow have some role on the information which are exchanged. And the channel model describes all channel effects relevant to the transfer of this information. Relied upon interfaces, RUIs. We call an interface of a constituent system where the services are offered to other constituent system a relied upon interface. Okay, I'm a constituent system. I make available a RUI, a relied upon interface, for interaction with other constituent system. And obviously, the system of system as a full entity relies on the services provided by constituent systems through these interfaces. We have several types of relied upon interfaces, at least three. The first two are more technological and physical, if you want, because we speak about relied upon message interface. RUMI is a cyber message interface. It's my TCP token. Okay. Or any other protocol. Then we have the RUPI, physical interface where things or energy are exchanged among the constituent system of the system of system, obviously through the environment. And then we have relied upon service interface. A constituent system service that is offered at the relied upon interface of service providing constituent system service under a service level agreement. Okay, this is a higher abstraction level because I am a constituent system. I provide a service interface with some service level agreement to other constituent systems. And then the actuation, the real exchange of information, can be a RUMI or a RUPI. The service level agreement is within the specification of the relied upon interface. See, I provide this relied upon interface with this level of service. Then you get there, you see the stuff, you can forecast some sort of service discovery protocol, which explores the available interfaces with their service level agreement, and the constituent system decides whether to make a connection or not. Again, in the service level agreement. Is a contract at the end. Yeah. We can have also other interfaces because these are the functional one in a sense. We can have also time synchronization interfaces where external time synchronization can be performed to establish a global time base, and also utility interfaces used for the configuration control or the observation of the constituent system. Now, for example, it could be very popular to monitor a constituent system in order to get anomaly detection or intrusion detection alert and so on. So essentially you need to have this kind of interface which allow controllability or observability of this constituent system in order to make all these kind of services, which are, in a sense, provided again by another constituent system. You can imagine that there is a constituent system specialized in monitoring and making anomaly detection for a set of constituent system. And you have to have a specific interface for that. In fact, you see utility interfaces for configuring, diagnosing, or updating the system. Well, if I want to update a constituent system, I must have rules to get my hands inside. there's diagnostic interface, monitoring of constituent, monitoring constituent system is a constituent system that monitors the exchanges. Essentially, the monitoring is mostly at the interfaces where information are exchanged. So that is the really critical information to understand whether the system of system has problems besides inside a proper constituent system. How long do you want to go? General question. Okay, we can do. I think that in half an hour we can finish this part. Okay for me. Okay for me. Say, not recently, but some years ago, I was contacted by a company to give a 40-hour course on fault-tolerant architectures in 5 days. So, I don't know whether now I could do, but there were a lot of exercises as well, I must say, because otherwise you are not surviving this much. Dynamicity and evolution. So, large-scale system of system are thought and designed for being used for many, many years. Okay. We cannot imagine, or if you can, please tell me, but I cannot imagine a huge system of system in which the lifespan is 3 years, 2 years. I'm not able. I can imagine systems that should go for 20, 30, 50 years, if we speak about huge systems. Okay, so they are designed for a long period of usage. And over time, the demands of the customers, of the users, of the owners are going to change. Even because technology will change, and so the system will be subject to further requests or different requests from the users. This is very likely. Or there will be constraints, as I said, new standards coming out, new regulations, new agreement. Say, imagine that our Minister of Internal would like to become friend of the Russians. So all the defense system should be, if he succeeds, modified to be integrated with the Russians one. Okay, this would be a change. A big change for the system, which is not a technological, given by different constraints. Suppose also a system of system in which companies have huge parts, and you may have different policies among companies which were friends and becomes enemy, or vice versa. Obviously, this will dictate some changes in the structure and the governance of the system of system. Okay, so there are many external events that can have an impact in changing the requirement for the system of system. Then we have short-term changes. We refer as dynamicity, emergencies or faults or disasters or recovery of something is a short-term. Short-term actions that need to be performed. And okay, this is the difference. Evolution. We don't want to give any positive or negative meaning to the word evolution. Simply changes. for the best, for the worst, we don't care. Evolution for us refers to maintaining and optimizing the system. Maintain the system update and to be able to continue to use it for good. To keep the mission, if you want, to keep the goal. We have managed evolution in which the evolution has some guidance. Okay. There is a guidance, we should change the system and evolve to go to its given direction, but the entire system of system should go in a given direction. Make some modification or change something. And it could be done for many different purposes. Performance, efficiency, new markets, whatever. So, manage the system of system evolution is the process of modifying the system of system to keep it relevant in face of a changing environment. Unmanaged, contrary, is unmanaged system of system evolution are ongoing modification of the system of system that occurs, happen, as a result of ongoing changes in some of the constituent systems. So the dichotomy is, I can plan globally an evolution, a change, and so I can drive a change of the system of system, or I can have changes because part of my constituent system have changed. Okay. Since the constituent system may not belong to the same owner, we can have the case in which the owner of some constituent system decided to change or evolve his fraction of constituent system. Obviously, they are still attached to the rest, and the entire system is, in a sense, changed. But this was not a global policy. It was driven by the changes of some. Here we have also the concept of reconfigurability. What is the capacity, the capability of a system to adapt its internal structure in order to mitigate internal failures or to improve the service quality? Okay, can make it. Make changes inside in order to that. Obviously, linked to evolution, there is also the concept of governance. Okay, of the system. There is a governance of a system of system. The governance calls for the concept of authority. Okay, the authority, the relationship in which one party has the right to demand changes in the behavior or configuration of another party, which has to conform to that. I mean, I have the authority to impose to someone else some changes. We can have also, for example, the European Railway Authority. If we talk of the system of system of the railway, has the authority to impose to all the other subsystem and constituent system changes if they decide to change some part of the standard. Okay, this is the authority to impose. Then we have also cases in which we have a collaborative system of system authority. So we have an organizational entity that has responsibilities, societal, legal, or business responsibilities to keep a collaborative system of system relevant to its stakeholder. I mean, I can delegate to a specific entity the governance of a collaborative system of system with the objective to keep the system of system relevant for the entire set of stakeholders. Okay. in this this kind of situation, SOS authorities has the authority to change the RUI specifications. Okay, and how these changes have to be performed. It's clear that if I have the authority to change the RUI specification, the constituent systems which are meant to interact through this RUI have to change. They have to conform to the new specification of the space. Okay, and this is the way we see a guided evolution of the system of system. Because it is also clear that if I am the owner of one constituent system and I want to change my constituent system, I will never be able or have the authority to change the interfaces. I can change the internal, but I have to interact through the same interface specification as it was. When someone has the authority to change the interface specification, then it is driving a change which will involve essentially the system of system, because the system of system is the integration and interaction of the constituent system. Okay, this is the difference. Design and tools. System of system architectures. Okay, we have a requirement. And some of them are not fulfilled. As a solution, we can think that the architecture of a system may have some variance or can vary during the operation. So we talk about evolvable architecture, is adaptable and able to incorporate changes both known and unknown. Flexible, which can evolve flexibly in several directions as it will be possible, and robust. A robust architecture is an architecture that performs well under a variety of possible future development. Okay. The architecture involves several components and so on and so forth. And we have a design process. Okay. Design process, we have a process like conceptual thinking, and after the concept we define the requirement and we map the requirement into an architecture. This is the design is the process of defining an architecture, components, modules and interface of a system to satisfy a specific requirement. This is what we do when we make a design. Modularity is an engineering technique that builds larger system by integrating modules. Okay, I don't want to build the system entirety. I try to make a decomposition. I build the several pieces, but the system is not, let's say, monolithic system, but is made of modules that can be then changed much more flexibly. Design for evolution. Since evolution is so important, we can talk about design for evolution. It's the exploration of forward compatible system architectures that can evolve with a changing environment. Essentially, if I apply design for evolution, I will end up with an architecture which is robust or flexible. If you remember the previous slide, okay? And to do that, we need to be modular. We need to favor updates, updatability, and extensibility. Expected changes must be accommodated without a global impact on the architecture. if I already expect changes, I should be able to accommodate maybe acting on some subsystems without changing the entire structure of the system of system. Okay. And then we have also the concept of design for testability. Architectural and design decision in order to enable easy and effective testing of the system. We should design having in mind the possibility to easily test the system. Last, you know that dependability and security I can talk for a long time. I will do dependability. Dependability is defined as the ability of a system to deliver a service in which we can trust in a justified way. What does it mean? That depending on the criticality of the service, we think the service is good enough for that. The system is good enough for that service. Namely, if I have to build a nuclear power plant, the quality of the system must be much better than a candy distributing machine. Okay? So the dependability is the adequacy of the system to the criticality of the function that it has to perform. So, concept of dependability can be split in these three parts. We have the threats to dependability. Threats are those things which will or may prevent us to deliver the proper service. Okay, a correct service. What are these threats? Well, faults, errors, and failures. Consider that here, when I speak about faults, I'm not saying operational faults or design faults or permanent or temporary or intentional or unintentional. Fault is everything which can be wrong. Even an attack by an hacker, for me, in this moment, is a fault. Okay. Then normally faults are transformed in errors. Errors are elaborated in the state of the system. And when these errors are used to make a visible action at the system interface, we speak about failure. A computer failure is a perceived deviation from the intended behavior. When I see that my system behaves in a way different from what was prescribed. Until that point, I have errors, I have faults, I have internal problems, but what I have to do is to look at the interface, and as long as the system behaves correctly at the interface, we don't have a failure. We have a failure when we have a deviation of the behavior at the system interface. Then, we have the attributes to measure dependability, because not all the systems are the same. For example, when I deal with the railway people, we are mostly concerned of avoiding disasters. But normally trains have a safe state. So if I stop all trains in an area, passengers may be unhappy, but nothing too bad happens. Okay. So, for this kind of application, the most relevant property is safety. And it is one of those listed there. If I speak about a teller machine, when I think to a teller machine, what I want is that it's, in a sense, preserve integrity and is available, because I want to go there with my card and be able to retrieve money, not find it out of service. And I want that if I put the card and the right numbers, then the cards and money comes out. Okay, and the machine is not giving money taken from my account to anybody else. So they are different properties than safety. When I talk to Embraer or these kind of people, well, if a plane has no safe state, when you are in the air, you cannot do like that and hope nothing bad happens. So in that, for that kind of system, the real important concern is that the system continuously operate correctly for an interval of time, normally sufficient to land. Okay? So in this case, the requirement is reliability. Okay? Reliability of a system is the property that the system works correctly at time t, given that it was working correctly at time zero. So it's a continuous service and must be longer than the mission. But again, reliability is a different property than safety. What do we have there? Integrity, maintainability. Maintainability is meant to shorten the downtime of a system. It's a property of a system that allows to shorten that. So what is the message here is that when I speak about dependable system, I mean a very general concept. A system is dependable if it is adequate for its purpose. Okay, if I can justifiably trust the system in providing its service. When I go to measure this, depending on the different system, I may have different criteria. Because for a train, I don't care of reliability of a train. For me, if a train has a small downtime every day, 2 minutes every day, is not a problem. Real problem is if it smashes against another train. For an aircraft, even the 2 minutes per day can be a serious problem. Okay, so each system has its own criticality and has its own attributes, which are important for that system and not important for others. So given a system, we have to understand which are the important criteria and work in order that a numerical value on these criteria is sufficient for a good usage. Okay? Then, obviously, we have the means to ensure. Let's say, failures happen, we can build good components, they fail less likely, but still they fail. If for our requirement is sufficient to use good components, fine, we are lucky. In most of the cases, this is not the case. I mean, the system has to have properties which go much beyond the characteristics of the component. Okay. If I want the probability of a train smashing against another of 10 to the minus 9 per year, it's not an issue of components, it's an issue of system design. I have to design in order to get these kind of features. Okay, so if the component quality is not sufficient, we have to move to fault tolerance. We have several means: fault prevention and removal. Removal is clear and easy. Say, some of you wrote some software, I guess. But no one of you wrote correct software at the first time it was written. Right? There were small or big bugs. And so before having your software running, you had to do some fault removal. You tested, you understood that it was not working. You tried to locate where the bug was. You corrected the bug. And when you corrected enough, then the system was working. But every time you corrected the bug, you made some removal. You removed one fault. Each patch for a fault is removing one fault. So it's very typical that in systems before they are deployed, you have a lot of testing, and when testing is not passed, it's not necessarily a bad news. Because it's a sign that there is a bug that you can find and correct. And so your system is improving. But again, you can improve, 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 and then there is a law of diminishing cost and reward, no? I mean, the more you test, at the beginning you find a lot with less effort. And then you test for weeks or months to find one further bug. And then you have to test for 6 months to find another one. The less the faults, the longer will be the process. So at some point you stop because you finish the money, you finish the time, and you have to stop. At the end of the day, you cannot guarantee that no residual faults are in your system. Luckily for me. Because it means that there will be always something to do. Right? And what we do is to apply fault tolerance techniques. Fault tolerance essentially means the following. A fault tolerance system is a system which is able to provide correct service despite faults. There are faults in components, but the system in itself is able to provide a good service. This concept was first introduced by John von Neumann. He wrote a paper whose title in the 40s, okay, title was How to Build Reliable Systems Out of Unreliable Components. So, you want to build a system which goes beyond your components. This can be considered also an emergent property, if we really want to consider it. So here you see a graphical representation of the chain, fault, error, failure. Because if you see a system in a hierarchical way, you can think that there is a component, piece of software running somewhere, a bug in your software, the bug is activated, I mean, the flow, the system executes that instruction which is buggy on data which determine a wrong execution. You have this written in some variable, then the variable which contains a value different from what it should have been is manipulated and processed again, and at some point you go to output something which is wrong. And at that point, you have the failure, which is the violation of your specification. But if this is a component in a system, this failure of this component becomes an error in the next level. Because you have something wrong, because this guy didn't make his job, you have an error, you can have the same propagation, and again, the outer component can fail until you reach the top level, which is the system level. So again, also this is recursive. Okay, and we have this chain. What do we need to do is these things. Okay, fault, error, failure, we have to break this chain. We have to intervene. Obviously, after the error, because we can perceive that there is something wrong only when we see an error, but we have to intervene there And this is fault tolerance. What we have to do is to eliminate the error which has been detected with some recovery action, error recovery action, and we have also to prevent faults to be activated again. If some of your circuit is broken, you have to isolate and use some backup, because otherwise you will incur in the same errors. So the actions that you need to do are to recover the system state and remove the faulty components. And then you can continue to provide service. Interesting is also, besides tolerance and removal, is forecasting. Okay, what is the scope of fault forecasting? Well, it's about making an estimation of the residual estimate number of faults, their future incidence, and their likely consequences, which means I try to make a forecast on how often and how my system will fail. For example, to be allowed to put some appliance in a railway in operation, we have to prove that the likelihood of having a catastrophic event is less than 10 to the minus 9 per year. So this is a forecast. Clearly, it's a probabilistic measure, but is exactly what fault forecast is for. I mean, it's not enough to try to make the best system possible. You have also to prove and to get confidence that the system is good enough for the function it has to perform. Okay? And this goes with a set of techniques, but the common goal is that one. I think I'm almost over. Just describe security and then we close. Security. A secure system is a system which is able to maintain confidentiality, integrity, and availability, which are three of the properties we saw before. Why I say confidentiality, integrity, and availability? Because I want the system available for the authorized users only. I want my secrets to be maintained and kept, so confidentiality, and I want my system to preserve its integrity. And an additional motivation or explanation of why security is confidentiality, integrity, and availability is the following. Suppose I am paid to act against the system. First thing that I will try to do is to get into the system and get the information which are there. Suppose there are all the designs for Embraer, all the project, the investment they've done in research. Obviously, if I can penetrate the system and I can get all these secrets, I can sell them to competing companies which will save all the money invested by Embraer. So this will be my main objective. So to break confidentiality. Second, if I can break integrity, means I can either cancel or break all their data. They lose everything. So competitors still can pay me because they couldn't get up as Embraer, but I took Embraer down to their level because they have to redo everything. If I cannot do this or that, what I can do is to prevent Embraer engineers to use this system. So I will attack availability. If I make the system unavailable, still I am making some damage. Okay, so essentially providing security is to be able to counter these three types of attacks or threats to our system. Security is a different beast than safety or reliability, because while for reliability or safety we have some mathematics which helps, we can make the assumptions that faults are random, that they have some distribution of occurrence, the probability that something fails, the failure rate of a processor or of any other component. When we speak about attackers and vulnerability, which are the probabilistic argument that we can bring? If there is a vulnerability and an attacker knows that vulnerability, it will be hours, days. So we cannot do the same kind of arguments that we are doing for safety or reliability or availability. Actually, what we want to try is to reduce the risk related to threats, which are attacks. Attacks are usually conducted exploiting vulnerabilities. Okay. Again, as for the dependability, perfect systems that do not exist. What normally people try to do is to make an attack so difficult and costly that the attacker gets demotivated. If I have to spend 100 to get 50, I will not attack the system. Okay? So to make the attack difficult enough for demotivating the attackers to attack that. Last, if you want to make money, you have to find vulnerabilities and the attack for that vulnerability, but not use it. And then try to sell it on the deep web. It's one of the most, increasing markets in the last 2 or 3 years. People are not performing the attacks, are looking for the attacks, and then are selling a zero-day attack. But obviously, zero-day attacks are very difficult to counter. Because people don't know of that vulnerability, and if you are prepared to attack, you can have success very easily. But a threat. Threat is anything bad. Okay. Potential to impact in a negative way the operations, the asset, the individual, destruction, unauthorized access, disclosure, modification, denial of service, in all the examples I made so far. Vulnerability is a weakness in a system or in a security procedure or in an implementation that could be exploited by a threat. So as in dependability, I have a fault and I have to activate the fault. If I have a wrong line of code that I never execute, system will never fail. Here, a vulnerability is a defect which needs an exploit in order to be activated and provoke damage. Okay, and the risk is a measure of, the cost of this process. Normally, risk is evaluated as some combination of likelihood and consequences. How likely is that something happened, and what are the consequences of this happening? Okay, obviously, if something is very dangerous and very likely to happen, is a high risk. finished. Here are some references, and this is over. My voice is almost also not in a very good shape. I will try to recover. I heard that Capirinha is very good for that. Isn't it true? It's true. So don't worry. Tomorrow will be in perfect shape.